Hey everyone, Avial Easter here with Yapa238.com, and I know this isn't the regular podcast intro, but I wanted to explain to you guys why I haven't produced a podcast within the past few weeks. So you guys, usually when I record a podcast, I actually record it maybe like on a Monday or Tuesday of the week. Well, I did that the last week of February, and then when the opening of March came, I attended the No Limits Conference, and so I wasn't able to release a podcast then. You know, there was service Wednesday night, Thursday morning, Thursday night, Friday, you know, just the whole conference deal. You know, listening to phenomenal preaching, just incredible preaching, to hanging out with friends, staying up till 3, 4, 8 o'clock in the morning. The Friday night, that's what we did, stay up till 8. I mean, just really investing into relationships. It wasn't necessarily me just like chilling, hanging out, neglecting my responsibilities. It wasn't any of that. It was, I knew that these people that I was connecting with, those people were only going to be here for like, you know, a weekend, 72 hours out of the entire year. And I only had one opportunity to really connect and invest into the relationships with these people. Wonderful, phenomenal people, kingdom orientated, kingdom minded. And so I took that opportunity to invest into those relationships. So the first week of March, I didn't get a podcast out. And during the No Limits Conference, very key people came up to me asking me, hey, Avial, how do I donate to the mission of Yapa238? So right after No Limits, I went to building the donations page for Yapa238. If you're looking to give to Yapa238, support the mission, support the vision, support the everything that's coming from Yapa238, go ahead and go to yapa238.com/donate and go ahead and donate to Yapa238. It'll be highly appreciated. 100% of the funds are going straight to furthering the mission of Yapa238. So yeah, definitely do that if you're interested. So I was hard at work building the donations page. And then from there, I wanted to launch the TOTDs, which if you guys have not heard what exactly a TOTD is, go ahead and go over to youtube.com/Yapa238, and go ahead and watch the video of the TOTDs. Pretty much what a TOTD is, it's an acronym standing for the thought of the day. We're pretty much Yapa238 coming at you every single day on Instagram, Twitter, YouTube, and whatever outlets we are on. So I was building the donations page, I was prepping for the TOTDs, the launch of those. And so yeah, that kind of took my time away. Also building the website, which is kind of difficult. It is still not completely 100% built out yet. Just because of everything that I put on my plate with the Yapa238. And yeah, but hey, if you have so much to do, if you have an incredible amount to do already on your plate, why not stack more on it? Stretch yourself, grow more, do more, act harder, work smarter. Why not do it? You know what I'm saying? We only live once, which is one of the TOTDs that that I've been talking about. We only live once, literally YOLO. And so why not do as much as we can in the kingdom of God, for the kingdom of God, as quickly as possible? You know what I'm saying? So now I am back at it. I'm behind the microphone. And yeah, I'm going to give you guys what I recorded actually the last week of February. So if it sounds kind of out of date with everything that's been coming out from Yapa238, just know that this was recorded the last week of February. It's good content. We're talking about prayer and we're talking about fasting. Phenomenal, always phenomenal content when we talk about prayer and fasting, because prayer and fasting is phenomenal in and of itself. But yeah, we're talking about that. So here is the podcast, the seventh podcast, numero sette, right? Number seven, the number of completion. The seventh podcast from Yapa238.com. I hope you guys enjoy it. And here you guys go. What is up, everyone? Avial Easter here with Yapa238.com, and welcome to the Yapastolic Podcast, the podcast where we talk about being young, being apostolic, taking that power and putting it into action. My brothers and my sisters and my sisters and my brothers, what is up, everyone? I've missed you guys, man. The Yapa 238 audience, the Yapastolic podcast listeners, You guys are fam. Oh my word, you guys are amazing. Oh man, dude, I love life. You guys, I love life. Yes, it gets difficult. Yes, it gets hard. Yes, it's trying at times, but man, we only have to live life. We can't do anything else. Can't do anything else except for live life. So you might as well make the best of it and laugh at your own jokes. Like you guys hear me doing all the time, or laughing at my own statements or thoughts or whatever. But hey, we only live once, literally YOLO. Like seriously, we only live once. So we might as well make the best of it, do something crazy, do something radical, do something radically apostolic, win souls, be saved, make it to heaven. We might as well do all those things, right? I mean, because why? We only live once. So live happy, live healthy, live hard. The triple H's of life. Healthy, happiness, and hard. Rah! For Jesus, right? No, seriously, guys. You guys are amazing. Man, I wish I could meet every single one of you. I get DMs, I get comments, I get different things coming at me. You know, Aviel, hey, where's the podcast? Or like, you know, they're asking me certain questions or asking me certain things. And I'm like, dude, I have no clue who you are, but you're like my favorite person right now because you actually are asking about the podcast. Oh, man. So you guys are awesome. But anyway, yeah, life's good. You guys, what is good in your life? Not that expression of like, yo, man, what's good? No, more like, hey, think of something positive. Tell me something positive that's going on in your life. You know, in the comments down below. But anyway, guys, so I'm super excited about this week, which I guess we're getting into the story of the week for today's podcast. But this week, man, the past 14 days, actually the past, well, yeah, maybe 20 days have been just so stinking amazing. Like seriously, the door that has opened up between Yapa238 and Holy Ghost Radio, I am just flabbergasted at just how everything has come to be. All the amazing traction, everybody coming, supporting Yapa, people following Yapa, people commenting, people DMing, people, you know, just really motivating me, pushing me, and being the being a driving force behind what I'm doing. It's like, man, people actually need this stuff. People actually want this stuff. You know, it's different if you need it. You know, like some people, you know, you need medicine. It doesn't taste good, but you need it. And some people are like, oh, no, you know, I don't want it. You know, and they'll like complain about it and they'll gripe and stuff like that. But when people actually need it and they actually want it, it's like, wow, man, all glory to Jesus. I'm just amazed at everything that the Holy Ghost is doing because people, young men, young women, young ladies, young gentlemen, you guys out there that listen to the podcast, that support the podcast, that are the views behind the podcast, that are the likes behind the podcast, that are those people, it really astounds me to see that the little that I put in, the little that I do here on Yapa238 or the Apostolic podcast, how that actually goes a long way and actually touches you guys. And so the synergy. You know, I put my voice out there and I give tips and I give, you know, helpful this and this and that's. And you guys come up with this fire that really just stokes. And I'm like, man, I know I'm in the will of God because people are actually, you know, fulfilling the vision that God had given me. And what I mean by that is that like back in 2015, when I first got the vision for Yapa, when I first got the inclination, you know, what I want to do with Yapa. And when God, honestly, God just put that in my head, that when that happened, I imagined it being like this. And it was a Holy Ghost confirmation. It was a prophetic idea, prophetic utterance or whatever. And there's been many prophecies and different things like that have come to me through my personal time of prayer about Yapa238 that I've actually seen come to pass. And I'm seeing it come to pass. You know, it's just amazing to see that. It's like, wow, man. So I'm super thankful for all you guys. I'm super thankful for everything you guys are to Yapa238. You guys are amazing. Seriously, I love you guys. I really wish I could meet every single one of you, you know, because again, it's just to be around people like that, you know, it's just, oh man, it's amazing. It's invigorating. And I'm just, man, big old smile on my face right now, guys. Now, with all my sentiments aside, let's jump into today's sponsor. Today's sponsor, the sponsor of this Yapa 238 Yapastolic Podcast number 007, the seventh one, number of completion, is the Man of Valor and I Am Phoenix Rising live stream. Honestly, guys, we have a phenomenal time every Thursday, 8 p.m. PST. We get down with you guys, the 40-something people. I think we're at 40 to 45 people now, regulars that join us on the live stream. We talk raw talk. We talk God talk. We talk young people, apostolic, where you're at, where you're living, talk. And we talk fun talk. And fun talk sounds like super, you know, a Chuck E. Cheese status. But but the fun talk, I mean, we talk about being young. Seriously, we talk about being apostolic. Seriously. And we talk about putting power into action. I mean, it's almost like Yapa all over again with Janesslyn in it, with my sister, I Am Phoenix Rising. It's seriously, guys, I'm telling you, this past live stream, oh my goodness, it went deep. It went down. I mean, we talk about so many things. It was absolutely incredible. We went from Adventures and Odyssey to Italy, to missions work, to Hope Corps, to I mean, just a ton of different things. We got down and dirty with the subject and no one likes to talk about, which was really awesome because, you know, Janessa just went there and she provided so much value, so much information, so much good apostolic, wholesome, godly tips on living godly. I mean, we covered so many aspects. And I love it because it's all off the cuff, you know, the community, the people who join us, the 40 to 45 people who join us every Thursday, those people, you guys are the ones that make the live streams what the live streams are. I mean, we just facilitate you guys commenting. I mean, I love it when I see one person ask a question, you know, hey, you know, how do I become more bold, or how do I become this, and or how do I do that? And everybody, I mean, you get 8 comments within, you know, what, 30 seconds to a minute, you have a flood of people from the live stream community. They're not doing a lot. They're not behind the camera, right? And they're just ones commenting, you know, hey, this is what I've done. This is what's worked for me. This is what. So if you're looking for a community of apostolics, young apostolics who are looking to do something great for the kingdom of God, be apostolic, live apostolic, do apostolic things, have fun as an apostolic ought to have fun, like young people ought to have fun, you guys got to check out the live stream, 8 p.m. PST, every Thursday evening. You guys will not regret it. You guys are going to love it. Go ahead and join us. I mean, just recently, I think we grew 8 people within one live stream, and already they're like super fam, and we're super close with them already, and it's only been a week. Like, they were on one time, and they were just sucked into the live stream community. Man, it was amazing. So we have a lot of people on there, all over the United States, even all over the world, from Sweden to, I mean, just a crazy amount of places. We got it all on the live stream. Go ahead and check it out. And that is a sponsor for today's podcast. So we got the intro aside. We got the story of the week aside. You know, we even got the sponsor aside. So what are we going to talk about in today's podcast? We're going to be talking about the two probably most important weapons in an apostolic Pentecostal's arsenal, okay? In a blood-bought, tongue-talking believer's arsenal, two of the most important things that anybody can exercise on a daily basis. Well, not really a daily basis, but especially the second one, you can't really exercise that on a daily basis. But these two weapons, I promise you, if you guys utilize them, grow your knowledge and skill set within these two weapons, knowing how to use them, knowing how to utilize them, knowing how to do them properly, I promise you guys are going to be equipped with the two, probably the most defensive and offensive weapons that we have as young apostolics. Okay, what is it? It is prayer and fasting. And we're going to take more than just the power behind it type of look at it, though we will touch on that. We're going to take a very logistic orientated look at prayer and fasting so you guys know how to do it right and how to implement it appropriately. So you know what? I'm going to ask Siri right now. Siri, help me out. Okay. Hey. Yo, Siri, are you there?
Always.
Always there. Always there, Siri. Okay, ready? Siri, define logistics.
Logistics means the detailed coordination of a complex operation involving many people, facilities, or supplies.
Now, prayer is not necessarily a complex operation, but there are complexities to prayer that require us to operate them effectively and efficiently, and pretty much we got to know what we're doing when we pray and when we fast. So we're going to take a very logistic-oriented approach while we broach the subject of prayer and fasting. So this will actually be the Young and the Apostolic segment and kind of the PIA as well of today's podcast. So without further ado, let's jump into what we're going to talk about first, and that is prayer. So I got a little story for you guys. I'm sure you've heard it before. It goes like this. And when they were come to the multitude, there came to him a certain man kneeling down and saying, Lord, have mercy on my son, for he is lunatic and sore vexed, for often he falleth into the fire and oft into the water. And I brought him to thy disciples, and they could not cure him. Then Jesus answered and said, O faithless and perverse generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I suffer you? Bring him hither to me. And Jesus rebuked the devil, and he departed out of him, and the child was cured from that very hour. Then came the disciples to Jesus apart and said, Why couldn't we cast him out? And Jesus said unto them, Because of your unbelief. For verily I say unto you, if ye have faith as a grain of mustard seed, ye shall say unto this mountain, Remove hence to yonder place, and it shall remove, and nothing shall be impossible unto you. Howbeit, this kind goeth not out, but by prayer and fasting. So there are some things, there are some devils, there are some situations, there are some circumstances in life that don't come away except you pray and except you fast. Prayer is your channel to the miraculous. Fasting is your channel to the miraculous. All these things, both those things combined, give you faith, as we see in the Word of God, to see the demonstration of the miraculous, to see the demonstration of the Spirit of God in our lives, to see the power of God exhibited in our lives. That's what prayer and fasting does for us. So we need both of these. We need prayer and we need fasting, because if we only have prayer, we only have one piece to the faith building puzzle. So let's turn our attention to prayer. What is prayer? How do we do it? How do we do it effectively? And how do we grow that skill set of prayer? So guys, let me give you a disclaimer before we jump into today's subject. First, I want to say that everything that I'm going to be talking to you guys today about is something that I've learned, whether from teaching, from preaching, whatever it was from that I've learned or reading and things like that, or it was from experience, okay? And so these are my experiences. These are the things that I've been taught that I'm expressing to you guys. So hopefully equip you guys, skill you up, give you guys the necessary tools to experience the things that I've experienced. And I'm not boasting, saying, oh, you know, you guys got to be like me. No. I know where I've been. I understand it. And I'm mandated from God to express it to you. That's what Yapa 238 is here for. So no pride, no arrogance. I'm going to express it. I hope you guys don't, you know, think I'm saying, oh, you know, when I pray or when I fast or when this and this and that, you know, because I'm more interested in pleasing God than pleasing you or making myself, my own name, like be all like, yeah, you know, that doesn't make any sense to me. You know, I mean, the prayers that I pray in secret, I'm wanting them to be expressed openly, but that doesn't come when you're, you know, trying to express them openly. So I just keep my stuff in the back, you know, just do my little deal during my prayer time, during my fasting time. So I'm not trying to promote myself or say, you know, oh, I'm a prayer warrior, I'm a faster warrior, or whatever you call it. I'm not trying to do that at all. So please don't mistake anything that I say, anything that I express, in today's podcast as pride or anything like that. I'm just trying to give you guys what has helped me, what's worked for me, and what I know from experience has worked and will work for you. So the first question we're going to tackle on today's list is, what is prayer? Okay. And when you were young, when you were a new convert, when you first began to pray over your food, you know, before you left the house, whenever you were praying at the altar, et cetera, et cetera, I'm pretty sure someone told you that prayer is very simply talking to God. And that's true. And that's one dynamic of prayer. Prayer is just talking to God. If you're trying to pray someone through to the baptism of the Holy Ghost and they don't know, I've never prayed before, just tell them, hey, talk to God like if you're talking to me. Talk to God like if you're talking to your dad or to your mom or to your sister or to your brother. Talk to God like if he was an individual, a human being, and you were expressing your desire to know him, to him. Just that simple, you know? That is definitely one aspect of prayer, just talking to God. Now, if you're starting your prayer life, if you're starting, you know, 15, 20, 30 minutes, an hour a day, it's really just talking to God, praying the Lord's Prayer. You know, like we talked about in previous podcasts, I think it was number one. And like I talked about on the YouTube channel, 10 Tips to Jumpstart Your Prayer Life. You know, you just start with an hour a day praying the Lord's Prayer, you know, splitting it up and praying each section until you reach an hour. And that's really just the start of prayer. And again, it's just like talking to God. You just talk to God like if he was your friend, like if he was your father, like if he was someone who was close to you, and you say the things that you would say to him and commune with him. That is prayer. However, that is not the totality of prayer. Okay, prayer is that as well. But then, this is my experience. This is what happened to me. I grew from a place of praying, just talking to God as my father, to a place where prayer meant a portal into the supernatural. So I moved from a place of just talking to God as my father. And I still do that. That's still one dynamic of prayer. I don't care how big, how long you've prayed. You could pray for 5 hours a day for 50 years. You're still going to be talking to God on that level. Again, that's one dynamic to it. But as you mature and as you maturate, as you mature in the things of God, in particularly prayer, as you continue in that, what's going to happen is you're going to then see prayer as the door into the supernatural, as your portal into the spirit world. Okay. I heard it put like this, okay, from some very, very spiritual people that when you pray, you don't just talk to God. You don't just expose yourself. When you're growing into the spirit, when you're growing your spirit man, as you begin to mature, as your prayer life begins to age and to begin more consistent and all that, when that happens, you don't just entertain God. You don't just commune with God. You get the attention of hell as well. You get the attention of angels, both fallen and not. You get the attention of the spirit world because you have entered the spirit world through prayer. You have gone from a place of being a seed in the ground in the supernatural to now being a sapling, to growing yourself into a mature and mighty oak. And as you continue in your prayer life over the years, over the months, over the days, over the hours, over the minutes, when all that continues to accumulate, you are then going to be visible within the supernatural. The sons of Sceva, if you guys remember in the book of Acts, the sons of Sceva, they were rebuking this devil in the name of Paul's God, the name of Jesus that Paul preacheth. And the devils turned to him, said, Jesus I know, Paul I know, but who are you? Why? Because the sons of Sceva did not have that spiritual authority. They didn't have they weren't in the spirit world through baptism in Jesus' name, through the infilling of the Holy Ghost. And if not that, if they were baptized in Jesus' name, were filled with the Holy Ghost, they had no authority to where the devil would recognize that the power and the authority that was carried in Jesus Christ, carried in Paul, that authority that comes from prayer, that comes from fasting, that comes from being mature in the spirit world, the devils did not recognize that authority because the sons of Sceva did not have that authority, right? And so when you enter into the supernatural, you're getting the attention of the supernatural, and which is phenomenal though. It's phenomenal when you enter in on the right side of the supernatural, which we are. We're baptized in Jesus' name. We're filled with the Holy Ghost. We're apostolic young people. We're called of God. We have the blood of Jesus in us. He is our Father. He has adopted us, grafted us into the body of Christ, right? His blood courses through our veins. He shed his blood. He died for us. That is the God that we serve. That's our daddy. That's our Lord. That's our friend. That's the one who provides us the authority in the supernatural to access the supernatural. So when you begin to mature in prayer, prayer literally acts as your door to the supernatural. You get the attention of hell. You get the attention of heaven. You get the attention of angels. You get their attention because why? You are in the supernatural. They can see. God can see you. The devils can see. They know that you're doing something. You're entering into the supernatural every time you pray. Literally, the supernatural world is all around us. We just can't see it. Why? Because we are in our natural selves. We are in our flesh and bones. But when we get into prayer, we begin to shed away that flesh and bone. And we begin to enter into the spirit world, and prayer is a portal to that. And so that's why I say prayer is a portal to the supernatural, because honestly, over my experiences, what I've been taught, what I've heard preached, prayer is that. Prayer is your portal into the supernatural. Now, the reason why I've expressed that to you guys is so that when you guys mature, when you guys get older in the spirit, when you guys mature in prayer, you guys can then begin to think of prayer as, okay, I once was just talking to God. I'm gonna keep talking to God, but I'm growing the spirit. I'm getting the attention of the supernatural. I have the authority over the devils that I'm getting the attention from, you know, so you can know these things, and that's going to propel you forward and further, so that when you see something in the supernatural, when you have a vision, when you see an angel, when you feel the presence of the Almighty God standing in the right corner of the room, when you feel an angelic being, you know, sitting at the top of the pulpit, when you begin to experience those supernatural encounters, just know it's because you've built up your spirit man. You've been in the spirit world. And so not only are you getting their attention, but you're becoming more sensitive to the supernatural, whether devils, angels, God, et cetera, you're getting more sensitive to the supernatural. Now, the benefits of prayer are endless, 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 because honestly, guys, it's, you know, our spirit man, after it's all said and done, when we die, when our flesh goes away, we're either going to heaven or hell. So if you're used to being in the spirit world and used to being in contact with heaven, it's going to be a whole lot easier for you to make it through life, especially if you're in contact with heaven, die, and then go to heaven, because you've been there before, not necessarily the physical or supernatural location of heaven, but you've been communing with God. You've been communing with your maker for years and years and years. And so he has a relationship with you. If we look at Matthew chapter 7, verse 21 through 23, we see something that's very, very scary. The Bible says, "Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord," these are the words of Jesus, "shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Many will say unto me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? And in thy name have cast out devils? And in thy name done many wonderful works? And then I will profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye worker of iniquity." He never knew you. Though you did all these great exploits for him, he did not have a relationship with you. He did not know you. If you think of to know someone, especially in the context of the Bible, that was a very, very intimate thing. Adam knew his wife Eve and bear a son. If you do not get intimate with God in prayer, if you do not get intimate with God on that level in the supernatural through the avenue of prayer, He's not going to know you. He's not going to know you. He can't know you because you haven't expressed yourself to him through prayer. So prayer is vitally important, not only to experiencing the authority of the Holy Ghost, as we see in Acts, but also as we see in Matthew 7, it's vital to you getting to heaven, your salvation. So your salvation, your spiritual formation, spiritual authority is all linked to prayer. And thousands, I mean, probably millions of more benefits come from prayer. But we have to know how to pray and how to pray right, how to access the supernatural in the right way. Okay, so let's turn to the logistics of prayer. Okay, some things that have helped me keep my prayer life, some things that I've had to war against in order to keep it, some wake-up calls, different deals like that. We're going to jump into it right now to talk about the logistics of prayer. First is a daily prayer life. That's probably the most critical thing you have to have if you're going to live for God and experience the authority, the salvation, the power that comes with prayer. So first, you want to have a specific location, a location where you and God meet on a regular basis. God is omnipresent. He is everywhere at once. But for you as a young person, you need to have that spot of prayer where you say, okay, when I get into this room at this time, whether it's your room, it could be a closet, it could be, you know, in your backyard, out in the forest, wherever you need to go to pray. Every single day you go there, create that location. Remember, God's omnipresent, like we just said. So he's everywhere at once. He's ready to meet you anywhere, but you want to have a location where your mind says, boom, pray, because it's this time and it's this environment. So you want to have a physical location. Let's say your room. We're going to use that for this example. So let's say I pray in my room every single day. Now you want a specific time, whether in the morning, whether in the evening, whether in the afternoon, you know, find a time to pray. Now, there is something to early morning prayer. We find it in the Word of God. I don't know. You know, there's just something to early morning prayer. From what I've heard people teach it that, you know, the spirit world is more active in the early morning. Again, I've heard that. I have not particularly practiced that for an extended period of time. And what I mean by that is that I haven't practiced that idea. You know, when I first started praying, I would pray in the mornings, early mornings, you know, 6 o'clock, 6:15. I'd pray from that time to maybe 7:15 or maybe sometimes 5 to whatever. But I prayed in the early morning for months. And there were spiritual things that happened, but honestly, and this is where I'm coming from, I like to pray whenever I'm the most alert, because I want to give 100% of my mental capacity to what I'm doing in that time of prayer. Okay, personally, the most dynamic prayer times, the most expressive supernatural experiences that I've ever had was when I was praying in the afternoon. Okay, the way my schedule worked out, I was homeschooled, and so I'd be, you know, at 1 or 2 p.m., boom, shut the books, I'm going to pray. Went into my room, prayed for an hour, and I had the most dynamic experiences during that time. Now, I don't know if it's because of the stage and where I was at. You know, I had been praying for a year and a half already, and from that year and a half time to maybe 3 years, 3 or 4 years into my prayer life, I had then moved from, you know, being kind of a young sapling to kind of getting my strength and my spirit man getting its strength in the supernatural. So I don't really know if it was that or it was because of my alertness when I went to pray. But if early morning prayer doesn't work for you, if you're groggy, if you're tired, then I would suggest, you know, if you're falling asleep during prayer, I would suggest changing the time to the afternoon or the, you know, later morning or evenings. Honestly, some of the most dynamic, most intimate times of prayer. Okay, if I had dynamic visions and confronting demonic forces in prayer, all that happened in my afternoon. But the most intimate times of prayer, the most intimate, came when I'd pray at 8 p.m. 8 p.m. to 9 p.m. And I don't know. That's just how it worked out for me. So what I'm saying to you is to pick a time, whether it's the mornings, evenings, or afternoons, you know, test them, see which one works best for you, whether you're alert. If you're alert in the morning, then hey, pray in the mornings. You know, just recently I started praying 5 a.m. to 6 a.m., you know, 6 a.m. to 7 a.m. So I pray in the early mornings. But find that time that works for you, where you're alert, where you can commune with God, where you're intimate with Him, where you can put all your energy and all your soul into what's going on during that time. So find that time in that location, okay? And then, this is the third thing, you make that an hour-long time of prayer. Make that hour of prayer happen, okay? Now, the reason why I'm so emphatic about an hour of prayer is because anybody can do it. If you're serious about God, which, you know, all of us are, hopefully to an extent. If you're serious about really starting your prayer life, you'll find that hour, okay? It's not hard to find, and you will stay in the presence of your lover for that hour, in the presence of your king for that hour, in the presence of your master, your Lord, your Messiah. You will find time to spend an hour with the Messiah of the universe, okay? The one who conquered it all. You will find time, and you can make the time in that location for 1 hour to pray the Lord's Prayer and then grow into praying as He leads. Okay? So you have the location down. Now you got the time. Now you got the hour. Again, the Lord's Prayer sliced up. And for those of you who haven't listened to the podcast, the number one podcast, I'll kind of repeat real quick the Lord's Prayer. You're going to pray the Lord's Prayer, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Then you're going to split it up into six segments with six themes, and then you're going to pray that for 10 minutes, 10 minutes, 10 minutes, 10 minutes, 10 minutes until you've reached an hour. And you're going to do that over and over again. Every single day as you pray, you're going to pray, boom, an hour, boom, Lord's Prayer, an hour, boom, Lord's Prayer, an hour, boom, Lord's Prayer, an hour. You're going to do that until you get your spiritual footing, until you get strong with that prayer. And then you're going to move into the next dynamic to prayer, which is spirit-ledness. So you have your place of prayer, you have your time of prayer, you know how you're going to pray if you're just starting out. And then you're going to grow after 3 months. You're going to grow into asking God when you pray, God, where is your spirit going today? God, who's on your mind today? I know the world is on your mind, but who can I pray for right now that is on your mind? What's on your heart? What's your heartbeat? Is your heartbeat the world? Is your heartbeat Israel today? Is your heartbeat, where is your heart? What should I be praying for? And then you're going to exercise that. And that is going to skyrocket you, blow you into the next ether with the dynamism within your prayer life because you're learning to be spirit-led. So you want the place of prayer, you want the time of prayer, you want the Lord's Prayer when you start out, then you want to begin to be led by the Spirit, okay? And those things, if you do those things, I promise you, you're going to find yourself within 6 months, within 8 months, within 10 months, a year's time, you're going to go from no prayer life at all to being astounded by what the Holy Ghost shows you in your prayer life. Okay. Now we're going to move into some things that you guys should be aware of as you venture and build and cultivate your prayer life. So the very first thing that you have to be aware of when you go into the supernatural, when you begin to pray, when you begin to exercise yourself in prayer and grow your spirituality, your spirit man, the first thing that you're going to have to remember is that the Word of God never contradicts the Spirit of God. So you're never going to hear something in the spirit world that does not line up with the Bible and it be right. That's never going to happen. Never in a million years, that saying that God contradicts himself. Yeah, and that's error. So when you do get a word, quote unquote, a word from God that contradicts the Bible, that word from God, quote unquote, was wrong. Okay. Hey, you're in the supernatural. If you don't want to be wrong in the spirit, don't go in the spirit, but you have to go in the spirit if you're wanting to commune with God. So you're going to have to be willing to be wrong. Okay. Be willing to be wrong. Know that you miss God. If it was really a spiritual deal that you really felt, you know, a spirit move on you and give you a word that contradicts the Bible, that spirit that you thought was God, was not God. That was a false spirit. And that's why Paul writes in Galatians 1:8, but though we or an angel from heaven, even an angel from heaven, preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. So even if you feel a spiritual like uplifting and you get a word, quote unquote, from an angel or a spirit or anything like that, and it contradicts the gospel, contradicts the word of God, that is not a good spirit, and you just heard something that's off. God's never going to contradict his word. So know that going into it. And the next thing you guys need to know when you're starting your prayer life is that every word that you ever get from God has to be submitted to your man of God, to your parents, to your spiritual authority. It needs to be submitted. Okay. It's the same thing like what we just talked about. Okay. You may be hearing something from a false spirit, a spirit that's trying to cause division. And so you say, you know, hey, you know, dad, I feel to do X, Y, Z. And he's like, you know, I don't feel that. Yeah. There's something wrong with that. Don't get all, well, you know, I got that in prayer. I got that. You know, don't get like that. Okay. Because you may be off and there may be a spirit that's trying to, that's trying to cause a wedge of division between you and your spiritual authority and is giving you a false word so that that can happen. So you have to be obedient to God. Okay. You have to understand that the word of God, the spirit of God is never going to contradict the word of God. Okay. And all the words of God that you get need to be subjected to your spiritual authority, right? We have to be, you know, we got to stand, say, nope. If my spiritual authority does not believe what I'm getting from the spirit world, you know what? I'm going to submit that. I'm going to say, man, I'm off. Be willing to be wrong and keep moving forward. Now, the next thing on the list that you guys have to know about when you are venturing into the supernatural and maturing in your prayer life is that the devil will attempt to take your prayer life away from you. And the way he would do that is by getting you distracted, you know, putting a girl in your life, putting a guy in your life that will detract from your relationship with Jesus, quite honestly. And so he would try to put that in your life. He'll try to use anything, school, your college courses. He'll try to use anything to get between you and your prayer life. Now, I do understand and know things happen. Let's say you're praying in the afternoons for, you know, many, many years, you're homeschooled and you hit the college scene and you just can't pray in the afternoons. Well, what do you have to do? You have to adapt. You have to adapt. You have to say, okay, well, I'm not going to pray in the afternoons anymore. I'm going to pray in the evenings. Or I'm not going to pray in the evenings anymore. I'm going to pray in the mornings. But you're going to pray a 24-hour period. You have to resolve this in your mind, in your soul, in your conscience, and who you are, that a 24-hour period will not go by without one of those hours being where I commune with God. Even if I have to stay up till 1 o'clock in the morning doing my schoolwork, doing my whatever. I mean, think about it. If your friend came over and you guys are chilling after youth service or something, you're liable to stay until 3 o'clock in the morning just talking about random stuff. You know what I'm saying? What if you took between 2 a.m. to 3 a.m. and talked to Jesus? You know, you have to be that, you know, dogged about it. You have to be that ferocious about keeping your prayer life, preserving your prayer life. Don't let the devil have it. Don't let circumstances have it. Don't let life have it. You got to make time to get into the presence of God and pray for your hour. Okay. And so those are some of the things that you guys have to be aware of as you guys begin your prayer life. Again, you need your location. You need your time. The time that you're going to pray, you need that. You got to do it every single day. You need your time. You need to understand that you're going into the supernatural, that you're maturing in the supernatural. You got to know that the devil's going to try to take it away. You guys need to know all those things so that you guys aren't, you know, missing out on the beauty and the beauties of prayer. You know what I'm saying? Where you're going to go, what you're going to do in the spirit because you were prayerful and you had the spirit of prayer on you. So now that's prayer. Again, you got your location. You got your time. You got how you're going to pray, you know, from the Lord's Prayer to being led by God. You need to know that the Spirit of God is never going to contradict the Word of God. You need to know that you have to be submitted to spiritual authority while you go out there and pray, you know, and you need to know that the devil is going to try to take away your prayer life through circumstances, situations, things like that. So be aware of those things, fight against those things, develop your prayer life, and yeah, you'll do phenomenally. I can't wait. I can't wait to hear the testimonies of people whose prayer lives have kicked off real strong, real hard, you know, from these teachings, these podcasts. I'm excited about that. So let's jump into fasting, a subject that has not been covered on Yapa238 yet. Man, this is the first time we're talking about fasting. This is pretty cool, you guys. Okay, so let's begin with a personal testimony. So I believe it was the ending part of 2015, and I felt, you know, I need to actually start committing one day a week to fasting, just one 24-hour period out of my week to fasting, right? Kind of felt impressed to the Holy Ghost to do that, so I started doing it. Every Thursday, I'd begin at, well, Thursday at 12 a.m., and end my fast Friday at 12 a.m. It was super funny, guys, because I would stack food up. Anything that was cooked throughout the day, I just put it in Tupperware, put it in the refrigerator, and I'm waiting. It's like 11:59. It's in the microwave. I got the fork in it already. I'm pulling it, you know, it's in my lap. I got the napkin tucked into my shirt and everything. I'm ready to grub, you know, and that happened for so many weeks on end. But I decided, you know, I'm going to take a 24-hour period out of my week to fast, okay? And I did that for a long, 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 long time. Well, weeks and weeks and weeks. And finally, I asked the Holy Ghost. I said, okay, God, because there, honestly, it was mid-Thursday. It was like 10 a.m. And I'm like, oh, there's some really delicious food. I forget what it was, but it was something super tempting where I was like, God, seriously, like, why do I have to fast? And then the Holy Ghost spoke to me and he said this. He said, because a lot of people fast when they need something from me. And if it was weird, it was almost like he spoke the word and that began to spill out. And I grasped this from what he was saying. So we pray and we fast when we're in a crisis, right? That's not when we're supposed to pray. That's not when we're supposed to fast. We're supposed to build up and from that, I kind of got this concept of spiritual bank accounts where I put in every week an investment into that spiritual bank account. So the temptation to eat kind of went away. I kind of just mulled through it. You know, I was going into my time of prayer that morning and I went in with what he had just spoken to me. And I'm like, man, wow. So every time I fast, I'm putting into my spiritual bank account of fasting so that when the time comes where I need an answer from God, I need to pray, I need to fast, I need to get a hold of heaven. When that happens, I would have the resources, the fasting to put and say, hey God, here's my debit card. Boom, swipe that thing and the answer comes. And the thing is performed, the miracle is performed, whatever it is. And so that's honestly what I've been doing. Since that time, not every single Thursday, you know, during some conferences, you know, I wouldn't fast. And no glory to me at all, in no way. I want to tell you guys, I want to show you guys just how possible it is and the impact and the magnitude of what happens when you fast every single day. Or not every single day, once a week, every single week, when you fast every single week for an entire year. I had fasted in 2016. Again, no glory to me. I want to show you guys the magnitude of it. Okay. 52 plus days. So 52 plus days. If you were to combine all that and, you know, see, and it's funny because some people think, oh, Avo, you're doing all these great things for God. The hand of God's on you, this and this. I've had people tell me that. I've accepted that humbly, but it's not some, oh my goodness, how did he get the hand of God on him? Like, how is he doing Yapa238? Why would God just speak to him when he's just stepping and walking throughout the day? The Holy Ghost telling me that he's just speaking to the community with me. It's not because of I oh man, I just have some genetic makeup that made me a little more, holier. No, that's a joke. That's a massive joke. No, that's not what happened. It's that when nobody knew my name, when nobody knew anything like that, I was fasting, I was praying, I was communing with God. And so I, 52 days, over 52 days. And so that's where I'm like, I rest on what the Holy Ghost has done. Man, this is awesome. This is great. Yeah, thank you so much for acknowledging, hey, the hand of God's on you. Like, thank you so much. I'm humbled by that. I really appreciate it. But to all those young people who are like, man, dude, who like, wow, I want to get there. It's like, well, go start fasting, go start praying. Wait a couple years, let that spiritual bank account mature so you can start swiping that debit card, that spiritual debit card, and start getting things from the Spirit. Hey, God, I have a burden, I have a calling, I have 30 days of fasting behind me. Let me swipe this card. It costs 15, it costs 20 days of fasting in order to experience the next level of this and this and that. All that will happen as you continue to pray and as you continue to fast. So we're talking about fasting. So let's begin with what is fasting. Very simply, and here's how I define fasting, is you are denying yourself something that is pleasurable to you for a particular season to get something from God. Okay, kind of straightforward, kind of apostolic, because some people, fast for natural reasons, stuff like that. But we're taking it as supernatural because we're trying to get something from God. So that's fasting. That's kind of the basic definition of fasting. Now, why fast? Why should we fast as apostolics? Well, the reason for it is it kills your flesh. Fasting literally destroys the body. It literally begins to kill your flesh. And you want your flesh dead in order for you to commune with God on a more intimate level. In order to be more spiritual, you need to submit your flesh, kill your flesh, and slay your flesh. Now, your natural man, you cannot physically kill your natural man, okay? Don't do that. Don't do that. That's called suicide. We're not doing that. What we're doing is we're denying the things that we like, the pleasures of eating, the gratification that we get from food, from sweets, whatever we got going on. And we're taking that and we're submitting it for a season to a particular cause, such as, maybe you're looking for a miracle to happen in your life. And so you push back the plate. You're going on a 3-day fast for God to intervene in a certain situation, or you're going on a 7 or 10 day fast because you want that apostolic power, the demonstration, you want to see miracles. So you go for 10 or 15 or 21 days, Daniel, well, he was fasting for 21 days to get an answer from God. So there's different reasons for fasting. There are different benefits of fasting. As Jesus said, some things come not out, but by prayer and fasting, the whole kid with the devil in him. And the disciples couldn't cast them out. He said, some things don't come out but by prayer and fasting. So that's another benefit of fasting, is that you get stuff done in the supernatural. Fasting builds faith. Fasting gets the attention of God. You're saying, God, help me. I need you. I'm fasting. I'm pushing away everything, or the main thing that sustains my life. I'm pushing that away so I can connect with you, God, because I need an answer. That's the power of fasting. So the first type of fast, well, there's two types of fasts, in my opinion. There's like non-food fasts and then there's food fasts. And the purpose of the fast is a sacrifice to God, at least from what I've been taught. Okay, you're sacrificing yourself and you're killing your flesh through the sacrifice of food, right? And so we have food fasts and non-food fasts. And generally with the non-food fast, like, Instagram fast or technology fast or those things like that, generally that's when we kind of notice that technology, Instagram, Twitter, whatever it is, Facebook, is kind of dominating a particular portion of our lives that we don't want to be dominated. And so that's kind of when we go on those non-food fasts. So first, if you're feeling like, you have too much of YouTube on a daily basis, if you have too much of Instagram on a daily basis, too much of Facebook, too much of Snapchat, whatever you feel you have too much of, go ahead and go on a fast. Go and say, I'm not going to do XYZ anymore. I'm not going to get on YouTube for the next 21 days. I'm not going to get on Facebook for a whole week. I'm not going to do Instagram for 3 months or do something. I don't know. When you're fasting, if you feel something's dominating your life too much, go ahead and whatever that thing is, attack it, slay it. Go ahead and fast from it. And those are generally non-food fasts. Now, food fasts, okay, that's kind of like the truest version of fasting, right, is not eating food. And the first one that we're going to touch on is a meal fast, okay? Some people can only do meal fasts, you know, because of medical problems, medical issues. Some people can't go for a day. Some people definitely can't go for 7 days without any food or anything like that. So you fast a meal, and I completely understand there are situations, medical situations, where people cannot fast even a meal. They can't do it because their body reacts in a negative way. Generally, those people in those predicaments, they fast from other things, media or different things like that, that has their attention. That's something that they can sacrifice to show God, hey, God, I need you, and I'm sacrificing this for you. But now let's talk about the logistics. We're getting the logistics of fasting. And one thing that I think every apostolic young person should exercise is fasting once a week, okay? At least one time a week, one day, one 24-hour period, just that one exercise, putting into your spiritual bank account on that level of fasting for 1 year will put 52 days of fasting under your belt for a year's time. And it's only one time a week. And you do that religiously, you do that habitually, and you make that a pattern in your life. God, I'm sacrificing this day, this Thursday, this Monday, this whatever it is, I'm sacrificing this day to put into my spiritual bank account. And so that when I do need the help, when I do need fasting currency, I'm able to give it. I'm able to pay it. I'm able to, you know, put that money down. So I suggest to you guys listening on the podcast very strongly, find a time, find a day where you can practice fasting. Now, what I do usually is I have the same thing. Similar to a location, I have a day on the calendar, or excuse me, a day of the week where I fast, okay? Then I have a time, a very habitual, ritualistic kind of time. Now, I know that's kind of taboo language, but I have that time. It's either 9 a.m., I start my fast on a Thursday morning, or it's 12 p.m. where I start my fast on a Thursday afternoon. I start it then and I end it 24 hours later. If I wake up at 9:10 and I miss the 9 o'clock time, you know, I say, oh man, you know, I'll start at 12. I don't like going any other time aside from 9 or 12. Find that time for you guys. Find the day of the week for you guys, whether it's Thursday, Wednesday, Saturday. We only got 7 to choose from. So go ahead and pick one of your seven. And then what you're going to do is you're going to find that time. Maybe it's 3 p.m. to 3 p.m., 6 p.m. to 6 p.m., 7 a.m. to 7 a.m., whatever it is for you, go to find that time where you're going to fast for that particular duration, that 24-hour period, and you're going to begin to build into your spiritual bank account every single week. So find that week, find that time, and you guys are going to be amazed by just what happens and what you're saved from. You may not even know what you're saved from because you have 13 days of fasting underneath your belt. And it just happens a week, every week, boom, another week comes, boom, another week comes, boom, another week comes. You just keep going and going and going. And it's man, you guys are going to be amazed. So you have the day of the week you're going to fast. You have the time of the week you're going to fast, or of that day you're going to fast. Then you want to be as consistent with it as possible. Don't break it. Don't do anything that's just going to mess up your fast. You want to be as consistent as possible with that time of fasting. Now, the next thing we're going to talk about actually applies to this day, the day that you pick, and also extended fast. Okay. What I mean by an extended fast is a fast that lasts longer than 3 days. Okay. And generally what happens, because of the environment that we live in, you know, back then in the time of Jesus, they had pure food. It was 100% real, organic. They didn't even know what organic was because they didn't need to specify between the foods. You know, it was 100% natural. Well, in the 21st century, we have a lot of processed foods. We have a lot of foods that put toxins into our bodies. I think I heard a while back ago that they're even finding plastic in our cells. You guys, the time that our body spends deteriorating after death is longer than it was 200 years ago because we have so many preservatives in our food, so our body preserves itself. That's crazy. So we have a lot of toxins. We have a lot of this nasty stuff within our bodies, okay? So when we go on these fasts, our body purifies itself naturally. So if we're not careful, the toxins could build up in our bodies, okay? When we take in food, when we take in, it's kind of a little graphic, I guess you'd say. When we take in food, the food then turns in our large intestine, small intestine, it turns into some, you know, poop. It turns into feces, fecal matter. And that fecal matter is actually holding toxins within it. So when we defecate, when we use a bathroom, the toxins are being released that way. Also, when we take in a lot of water, that's why it's important to drink water. When we take in water, our body releases toxins through our urine as well. So with that being said, if you're not eating enough, if you're not taking in enough water, if you're not doing those things while you're fasting, a lot of toxins can build up in your body, especially when you go over 3 days. Okay, don't go over 3 days, okay, without taking in something other than water, because we have a lot of toxins inside of our bodies, held up inside of our bodies, that needs to get released through different means and different avenues. So if you're going on an extended fast, anything over 3 days, what I want you guys to do is make this solution, okay? It's like a juice, it kind of tastes like lemonade, but you're gonna drink that during your fast. You're going to also get a hold of some Smooth Moves tea, okay? I forget the brand. I'll post it on the website. You're going to get a hold of some Smooth Move tea, particularly for people who are, you know, have like diarrhea or something, or have bowel issues that need to have a bowel movement induced by the tea. You're going to get that, and you're also going to get some salt water mix. And I'll have all this stuff on the website. You guys can find it out. But the juice that I'm talking about is something I drink very often when I go on an extended fast, because I understand that, you know, I don't want the toxins inside my body. And what it is, it's about a, I put about half a teaspoon of cayenne pepper with 4 tablespoons of grade A maple syrup, okay, organic 100% maple syrup. And I put that in with 1 whole lemon in about 20, 24 ounces of water. Now, I don't know everything that that does to your body, that juice does for your body while you fast, but I do know some things, okay? The maple syrup has a lot of sugar in it, and sugar equals carbs, and carbs equal energy. So, like I said, how this kind of applies to the one-dayers, for those of you who do a one-day fast every day, but let's say you work in construction, let's say you work with, you know, it's heavy lifting or whatever, you can get a big jug of that mixture of that juice and begin to drink it throughout the day to replenish your energy. And that will help you during that 1 day of fasting. Again, a lemon squeezed, like a medium-sized lemon, squeezed out 4 tablespoons of maple syrup and 1/2 teaspoon of cayenne pepper. Mix that together with about 20, 24 ounces of water, and you're gonna drink that. And that'll give you energy to work throughout the day. But if you have like a very sit down kind of job, that kind of can just be like some relaxing drink that you drink. And I kind of shy away from that. I don't work laboriously. A lot of stuff I do is online. I'm working with Yapo. So a lot of the work that I do is online, so I can sit down at my computer. And so I usually just go with water for that day. But if you're going extended, again, you get those solutions. You drink the Smooth Mood tea before you go to sleep. Okay. And trust me, at 4 a.m., you're going to be waking up like, oh my goodness, gotta go. And then in the morning, you're going to drink a salt water solution, which is also supposed to induce a bowel movement, because you're trying to get the toxins outside of your body during the fast. And then as you go throughout the day, as you're running around busy, 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 you're going to get that solution, that I keep calling a solution, that juice, and you're going to drink it throughout the day so that you get your energy back. So if you're fasting, let's say you're on your 4th or 5th day, you can still go to school. You may feel lightheaded and stuff like that if you do too much while you're fasting, but you can still go to school and you still go to college, hit the bus and all that stuff. You know, you could do all that drinking the 4 tablespoons of maple syrup with the lemon and the cayenne pepper. So honestly, guys, with those 3 drinks, I did go on my longest fast that I've ever gone on, which was 10 days. And I sat very humbly. The Holy Ghost has definitely allowed me to do that. And I appreciate everything that has come from that fast. But I was able to do that off of those three drinks. And I'll drink those again. But right before I go to sleep, the smooth move, when I wake up in the morning, the salt water mix, which I don't want to get the measurements wrong. I'm going to put that over on the website. Go and check that out. Yapa238.com/#007. You'll find the drinks there and all the information about this podcast there. So if you're going on an extended fast, definitely have that with you. You're definitely going to want to be drinking those things. So that's the fasting, right? Those are the logistics behind it. If you want to go for 10 days or 20 days, I've never been 20 days, but I do know that if you go on an extended fast over 3 to 5 days, you should be drinking other things, other fluids, so that you continue to live, because you're not trying to like starve yourself to death. You're trying to live through your fast so you can continue to, you can see the miracle that you're praying and fasting about. Now, the benefits of fasting and praying together are endless, because God is endless, and you access the power of the Holy Ghost when you pray and when you fast. So I really, really challenge you guys to start a dynamic prayer life, a prayer life of an hour a day at one location during one specific period of time every single day. Take one day out of the week to fast, push away the plate for a 24-hour period. If you're doing any laborious work, then go ahead and make that lemonade, that maple lemonade. Go ahead and make that stuff, drink it so it can give you the energy. Again, the maple syrup, I think it has like anywhere from 200 to 400 calories in that drink, which translates straight into energy. So you're not depleting, you're not going to like fatigue or anything like that. But yeah, go for that, do that. Do those things, fast often, pray often, find that time, you know, maybe it's 3 p.m. to 3 p.m. and fast just water only. You know, tell God, I'm sacrificing this time. This time is for you. I'm praying, I'm fasting, et cetera, et cetera. Now, bring those two together, and I promise you guys have a recipe for apostolic demonstration. You have the recipe that gets stuff done in the supernatural, okay? What does prayer fasting do? I always thought of it this way. Prayer builds your spirit man. Fasting kills your flesh, ultimately making your spirit man bigger. So when you don't pray and you don't fast, you got your flesh on the rise and got your spirit man on the downcline, the decline. So you want to couple praying and fasting. So when you're fasting, especially when you're fasting, don't just say, oh, you know, I'm a fast, so I'm not going to pray. I heard someone say that fasting without prayer is a diet. And I heard that I was weak, because that's true. You know, what's the point of sacrificing to God if you're not talking to him about your problem that you're sacrificing about? You know, what that doesn't make any sense, at least to me. So pray fast. When you fast, turn up the prayer gears three times. If you're going to pray for an hour, you know, kick it up to where you're praying throughout the day. Talk in tongues while you're on your way to school. Talk in tongues when you're walking from first period to second period. You know, talk in tongues while you're out and about shopping. Talk in tongues. Stay, like, do your best to hold down the spirit of prayer on you while you're fasting, praying about the subject, the particular thing that you need an answer for. So do that. Pray, fast, couple them together, and I promise you guys are going to see amazing results. Now, I didn't get into the results that you will see in this podcast because they are endless. Like I said before, it's completely infinite what can happen when you couple prayer and fasting together. But you need to couple prayer and fasting together, especially as an apostolic young person, because as the old adage goes, if you pray, you stay. If you fast, you'll last. So I hope this podcast was beneficial. I know we didn't get into the big grand scheme of what can happen, because again, anything can happen when you pray and you fast. I hope to give you guys in this podcast the logistics, and I feel I communicated that pretty well. So definitely go ahead and subscribe to Yapa238 here on YouTube. We do a podcast every week. We're actually looking to do, if it's me and other people, but anyway, I'm looking to do a podcast every Friday and actually a new YouTube video every single Monday. And there's a lot of good stuff coming from Yapa238. I promise you guys, if you just give it 8 months, you guys are going to be blown away by the stuff that comes from Yapa238. Again, all because of the Holy Ghost, all because of prayer, and all because of fasting. So definitely connect with Yapa238. Follow us on Instagram. Follow Yapa238 on Twitter. We got things coming out every single day that I know you guys will love, that I know you guys will enjoy. So I'm super excited, super thankful for you guys joining me on today's podcast. Go ahead and subscribe to Yapa238 on iTunes. Hit us up on Google Play, whichever kind of phone you've got. If you're Android, if you're Apple, I don't care. Go ahead and subscribe. Do what you got to do. Stay connected. Stay awesome. And guys, be Yapastolic. Above all, be apostolic. And I'll catch you guys in the next podcast. This episode of the Apostolic Podcast, again, brought to you by Man of Valor and I Am Phoenix Rising's live stream. Hope you guys join us Thursday nights, 8 p.m. PST. Go ahead and check us out. Go ahead and check the community out. It's amazing, guys, what's going on over there. A lot of blessings, a lot of people. I mean, we cry, we laugh, we pray. We do everything on those live streams because it's apostolic and it's who we are. We have fun. We get down and dirty, talk about the real things of being a young apostolic. And guys, we give God the stage to say, to do whatever he wants to do. So check us out, live stream, 8 p.m. PST, Thursdays, and we'll see you guys then.